responsibility of every person in society in order to shape, form, and structure the country you live in. And if you're not going to vote, you have lost your voice already. If you're not going to vote, you lost your voice already. The challenge becomes this. You can never complain about anything you won't contribute to. Which means if you don't show up at the poll on Tuesday, don't open your mouth about a government in this country. Which means you have given it up, you have forfeited it, you surrendered it, you have said, okay, y'all do whatever you want. I don't mind, I don't care, I don't value it. It's not that important to me because I don't show up.
My God.
And I know it may seem crazy, but over and over you'll find out in the Bible they're not what we particularly call governmental votes, but you can learn a lot from the votes that happened in the Bible and then the circumstances that come behind them because of what man decided when they didn't even trust God or honor God in the process. Say to my neighbor, you better understand the importance of this thing. And by the way, just because you do not take interest in politics, politics has already took interest in you. They have already shaped laws to hold you, confirm you, guide you, direct you, to limit you and set you up. So even if you don't care about voting, the people that don't vote and that do vote have already shaped the limits of our life in a sort of a way that comes with government of man. But they do not shape the limits and lines on our life when it comes to the government of heaven. Say to your neighbor, I don't know if you know this or not. Some of us have dual citizenship. We have dual citizenship. Say, I'm a citizen of heaven and the United States. I got a passport to operate in both systems, both governments, both authorities, both powers, both understandings and authority. I'm not limited by one and I'm not governed by one. I'm already operating in both places. I can operate governmental naturally, but also step into the government of who the kingdom of God is in the same motion and function from them and not be limited by those customs and mindsets that have been put around us. Say amen, neighbor. Govern the importance of the value of your vote. Say, you weigh the price of it. Weigh the price of the ideal that people in the ideal with men and women were beaten, they were whipped, they were imprisoned, they were lynched, they were shot, and they were other atrocities that are beyond my mentality to even talk about. The vote literally means that they have a formal expression of your own opinion. You have a formal expression of your own opinion. It is your choice. It is your values, your view. It is as you as an individual and a body of individual. Voting is collective expression of the minds and the hearts of men and women. Voting is the collective expression of the hearts and the minds of men and women. It's a choice of the positions of men and women. And although it does not override the voice, the value, or the views of God in heaven. It does not override the views, the values of the voice of the God in heaven. But if you don't vote, you do lose your right to complain.
Yeah, yes.
The other side of that is either you can vote by voting or you can vote by not voting. But if you don't vote, someone else will make their vote count. And after all, it's all about math. It's just math. And whether you think you don't count, you do. When you show up in that vote, you show up and turn, push that lever, yeah, boo, you count. You count. And it ain't based upon how much money you got, it ain't about how a family you came from. It is your opportunity to shift society if you want to shift it, and if you don't, you won't. Not only that, but we get to elect the president. We have to remind ourselves, even in the election, that we do not, we're not electing pastors. You're not electing a priest. You're not electing a go in between or somebody's going to sit on the right side of God. You just elected a human to be in a position. Oh, you ought to give the Lord a praise right there. Just a minute. Come on, bring it down to its right level and position. And by the way, you only vote for one person over one country.
Jesus.
Excellent.
Stop believing that this country controls things globally. That is God's responsibility, not man's responsibility. Don't put that authority in the wrong place, or you will always be depressed. The Bible tells me in Psalms 22 and 28 that the kingdom is the Lord's and he is the governor among all the nations. I understand the snapshot of the United States, the black American, that 2 out of 5 children live in poverty and that we're more likely to be killed by police or being or suffer the abuse of police and all those things, and even that we still lag behind counterparts in wealth and income and health. But while those things are true, it's never a time to stay home. I'm of the ideal again that if you can't, if you're going to complain, you can never complain about what you never contribute to. Come on, either you're part of the problem or you're part of the solution. You're either one or the other, but you can't be both. You can't be on the fence wishing somebody else do something and we don't do nothing. We can't hope that, you know what, the government changes and we don't vote for the government. We can't hope that the governor changes and we don't step in and say something about the governor. You can't hope that the mayor does something different, but we won't change the mayor if they don't do nothing else. There's a part that God plays, but he also is living in you, so you hold the realm of what God wants to do on the earth, because God will put his heart on your heart to make you go into a booth and choose for who he wants for president.
Yes. Yes.
Don't disconnect who you are in the spirit and who you are on electoral day.
Amen.
Anyhow. So even in those pros, that your voting is important. It's a part of our democracy. It shapes the country. It determines who leads us. It's important that even in these years, the idea of what happens in the idea, it's not just about the presidency either. Please hear me. It's not just about the presidency. But in fact, there are 34 of 100 United States seats that are up for election this year. The Senate seats, all 435, all 400. If you want to change the government, this is the year we could actually change the government.
I know.
All, did you hear me? All 435 seats are up for election in the House of Representatives, and the seats are up for election. Voters can decide governor races in over 12 states in the country right now. 12 states can change governors right as of this week. Do you know that 5,920 of the country's 7,800 state legislative seats are on the table on Tuesday? Maybe you didn't notice, but we could shift 5,000 people in Congress this coming week. I know we want to blame it on God, but God put the responsibility on us. He has a theocracy, which means God rules everything, but he rules the heart of men so they can go into the governments of men and then rule for him in that place also. So you have an opportunity to change 12 governors Tuesday. You have an opportunity to change 435 representatives on Tuesday. 5,000 seats in the Senate could be shifted on Tuesday.
Yes.
And you telling me you don't need to vote? I agree with you, but the devil is a liar. I will tell you this, though, November the 9th, the day after the election, we will have chosen the 45th president of the United States and the leaders from all over the country, either with or without your vote. Challenge of it is that the next president is going to be governed who sits on the Supreme Court. He has to choose the next 2 to 4 different Supreme Court justices that will judge over things in the Supreme Court for this entire nation, probably for the next 40 to 60 years. And if you don't choose who they are, then if we don't choose the person with the right mindset, then the person with the wrong mindset will be set over every supreme decision of government for our country.
My Lord.
Favorite neighbor. What he said was, do you know how important the value of your vote is?
Amen.
Daniel chapter 2 verse 21 says this way, that the kingdoms of heaven rules in the kingdom of men. It is our vote that gives the voice of God in the opportunity and among our country. It shows our views and it reveals our values. It's part of our dual citizenship in the country. Going to Philippians chapter 3 verse 20, our citizenship is in heaven and we wait for our Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. We have to be active and engaged both in an earthly government and a heavenly government at the same time. Tell your neighbor, and whether you like it or not, you are anointed to do it. You are in the kingdom like Esther. You are in the kingdom for such a time as this.
Glory. Thank you, Lord.
That literally, 1 Peter says, we ought to submit ourselves to every ordinance of man, and for the Lord's sake, whether it be a king or supreme, the idea that is the will of God, that with our well-doing, we will put to silence ignorant and foolish men.
Well,
it means that if you become obedient, we become obedient and take our place in the earth, we can shut up all the loudmouth foolishness that's going on over the earth, and you can do it from a booth.
Yes.
Amen. Not just from church.
Yes.
Ourselves the real questions to go through the ideal of what is the ideal of these candidates, what's their voting records, what are their key issues, what are their words that they said but they didn't hold on to, are they qualified, as much information as you can take, you got to use it for your choice and for your vote. Tell your neighbor, do you know the importance and the value of your vote?
And the value of your vote.
Let's go, Bird. Let's help us with it. And the idea of what it looks like is this, the importance of our vote in Numbers chapter 13, the one we read to you. But the men went up with him and said that it be not able to go up against them, for they are stronger than we. And they brought out an evil report of the land which they had searched. And the children of Israel were saying that though we have gone and searched the land and eat up the inhabitants thereof, and the people saw it, and the men of great stature. Now what's interesting to me is this, is that the importance of the vote is powerful, because your vote shifts and positions this generation and the next one. Say it with me. My vote. Positions. This generation. And the next one. Now in Numbers, it's easy to be seen, because there was a vote, even though it didn't seem like there was a vote. The Bible says he had sent out 12 men to go spy out the land. They came back, carried all the goods of the land. But 10, I said 10.
Right.
I said 10.
Ten.
Had a different vote than the other two. Come on. In other words, when they got the idea of what do we come back and give a report for, and who will vote for the things of God, and who will vote for the word of God, who will vote for the mind of God, and who will, watch this, allow fear to intimidate them, that they will, watch this, allow their insecurities, infirmities, and their inadequacies, not to let them choose their destiny.
Well,
you know why people don't go to the voting booth? They don't believe that they're strong enough. They don't believe they're able to change the thing around them. The same challenge that these men had in Numbers chapter 13 becomes the same issue. It becomes from a spirit of fear. That's why the noise has been so loud. That's why the words have been so loud. That's why the issues have been so great. That's why all the threats and the name calling and all the racism and all the other things and classism and all the things have been coming. Why? I'm trying to bring a level of intimidation that your decision will be affected by it. That you will be busted, affected by the giants like them of their history. You see, they say, we remember the giants of Enoch. They weren't talking about the ones they just saw. That's ones they had saw before. So sometimes, because when we get the idea of our history of being free from slavery, but we might not want the responsibility of being free. So I don't take my responsibility with me on Tuesday, because I don't want the responsibility, don't want the authority, don't want the idea of that place to be able to take care of my family and make decisions that affect my community. Do I want that, or will I let the giants of what happened in slavery? Will I let the giants of the poverty around me? Or will I let the giants of what happened to my family make me think that I don't have a voice in this opportunity? Oh, shout. Come on. Come on. And so 10 of them decided that, listen, it's just too much for us. We can't handle it. We can't deal with this. And you know, they won't listen to us. Nobody will handle it. Matter of fact, it's too many of them, and my vote won't really count. Matter of fact, I'm scared of, and they said it, we can't beat them. We can't win. My challenge is this. God had already given them the land. So there are times we override the word of God with our worry. We override the voice of God with the idea of a victim mentality. We already see ourselves as lost. That's what it said. We see them as giants, but we see ourselves as... How do you see yourself? See, my challenge is when I go to the voting booth, I go as the one about to choose who's going to serve me. And even the president is a public servant. I'm going to say it one more time so you can get your spirit. Because we keep going in as a servant, don't realize you are choosing your servants. And if we could ever get the right mentality and break that mentality off our mind, we won't be worried about insecurity and inadequacies and all the issues of our own infirmity, about what could happen, what won't happen, what might happen, so I do nothing.
Come on!
That is the enemy. It's our time. It's our opportunity. You may stand up. You may show up. I can guarantee you will always lose the vote that you don't show up for.
Always
lose the vote. Always lose it. No matter how loud Caleb was shouting, no matter how loud Joshua was shouting, they had it. There was only two of them. And when they lost the vote, they lost the generation. Okay, here we go. When they lost it, the Bible says, God said to them, okay, I gave you 40 days to check out the land. Take your fight away.
If God tell you,
there's milk and honey.
There's milk and honey.
There is milk and honey.
There is milk and honey.
And then if you go see, and you bring some of it back,
you
ought to know the word was good.
Yes.
This is ain't the first time you've seen God work.
That's right.
First of all, if you was able to survive for 40 days around the enemy.
Wow.
Which means this, I gave you enough victories right around the enemy to know you had authority where you were. But you didn't want to take authority for where you were, nor go back and lead anybody else to the place you got it.
Wow. That's right.
And sometimes there's a spirit of selfishness among us. That I'll bring my grace, but I won't help you go get yours. I'll go get and see the milk and honey. I see all the great things that are over there, but my perception will mess up our whole generation.
Yes.
That literally a trip that should have took 11 days ended up taking 40 years because of a messed up vote between 10 people versus 10 people, and they lost a generation in an election. Bible says, matter of fact, if you read it over the next chapter, God puts it this way. He says, this generation shall not enter in.
Yes.
There was an election, 10-2, that wiped out a whole generation. Don't let this be an election that wipes out a whole generation. Because we were so scared, so fearful, so watch this, listening to all the voices that we didn't even stand up and take the right vote. Somebody say hallelujah.
Amen.
Amen. Give him a praise anyhow. Give him a praise anyhow.
Hallelujah.
Sometimes the challenge, even in the church house, is not being able to say that these things are real truth. So then we end up hindering our community from having mindsets and the authority to be able to go and do what they need to do. So we can't just reach you up and down the walls and not have you come out with a right mindset to be able to go and vote.
Yeah.
Amen. Two people.
Amen.
So in the challenge of it is, we got to understand the necessity of their vote. It's very important to vote. People died for this right.
Come on.
Don't you understand that bad officials are elected because good citizens don't vote?
Yeah.
One more time. Bad officials are elected simply because good citizens do not vote. See, how did they win that? And in some certain cities, I'm overwhelmed sometimes, huh? Because in some cities, and I know a couple of them, they have 40 or 50,000. Some of them have millions of people. And some of them have hundreds of thousands, like Wilmington. But only 5,000 votes could win a city. Even in Chester, come on. Only 1,500 votes can win a city.
That's right.
And there's 40,000 people in the city. But
that's right.
Yeah! You check it out for yourself. The last mayor election in Chester was only won by like 18 to 2,000 votes out of a city of 39,000 to 35,000 people. You check it out for Wilmington. It's a city of over 100, over something, over like, I think it's like 100,000 people. And watch this. The number of votes combined wasn't even 15,000 votes.
Well,
don't you tell me voting don't matter. Our decisions will affect the next generation unless we be messed up by the idea of fear, racism, and poverty, insecurity, our own identities, messed up by the old ideas of what we wish to be and what could happen, what can happen through us and even by us. So I vote because it's my right. I vote because it's my responsibility. And I vote because it's the way I set up the future for the next generation of my children. To your neighbor. I'm going to say this one more time. You better understand the importance and the value of your vote. Hallelujah, anyhow.
Hallelujah.
Matter of fact, it got so bad one time, Elder, that they literally said to God, they said to him, they said to Moses, look here, we would have, why did we die in the wilderness? We would have rather even go back to Egypt. That sometimes we would really stay in lack. Because it's more comfortable to stay in lack. Because I don't have to change to stay in lack. And I prepare much because I won't vote because I'm good where I'm at. At least I'm comfortable with this. I'm familiar with this place. And I don't want the future because it's going to demand something out of me that's different than where I am. So I'll sit back and let everybody else vote and I won't do nothing about it. And what we're telling God is I'm familiar and I don't want my future. You can stretch your hands to me and pray for me, all right? It's all good. See, the idea is it's going to cost time out of your life when you vote wrong. It cost people 40 years and a 10-2 vote. You know what's really challenging? It's been 50 years since the act of voting went through. And guess what? They already stripped parts of it down. And nobody has said nothing yet.
That's right.
Numbers 13, he goes on to say this way. He says, and they saw the giants, and they saw what was going on, and they came to the point in the idea that they chose out of fear not to choose to vote and go forward. They voted to stay still. They voted to stay back. Please don't vote to go backwards on Tuesday.
Amen.
Come on.
Bible says, for God has not given you the spirit of fear, but of power, love, and a sound mind. Voting affects what happens in this generation and the next one. It will continue to lead us in God's position, the idea of what happens. Not only does it do that, but it also does this. You'll see it in a couple different patterns in the idea of Scripture, what goes on in the Scripture when it comes to people doing what I call voting. It looks like voting. But there is a lot of times in the idea of what it is, the idea of political correctness is sometimes driven by it, and sometimes acceptance is also driven by it. You can look at it on next one. Go for me. Go next one, please. Samuel chapter 8 says this. All the elders of Israel gathered together and came to Samuel in Ramah and said to him, look, you are old and your sons do not walk in your ways. Now let us a king to judge us. So Samuel prayed to the Lord. Nevertheless, the people refused to obey the voice of Samuel and said to him, but we will have a king over us that we may also like be like all the other nations.
Come on.
And that our king may judge us and go out before us to fight. Take him in, neighbor. Stop trying to be accepted by the world.
Stop trying to be accepted by the world.
They literally was rejecting God so that they could become like every other nation on the planet. Come on. They said, we don't want God to be over us. We don't want that level of accountability. We don't want that level of accountable responsibility. We don't want to submit to him and honor him and value him for the position that he's in. We would rather have a man to obey than God to obey.
Yeah.
Give us a king.
Yeah. Wow.
All through Scripture, the idea of this vote kicks in. And when they choose Saul, say, choose Saul.
Choose Saul.
Now hear me now. They chose Saul. They chose Saul. And God went on to tell them, when you get this king, all these things are going to happen to you. He's going to take your daughters and make them bed service and service, and they're going to serve in the house. They're going to take the taxes from you and take your money from you and all those kind of things. Now, in fact, not only that, your sons are going to have to go and fight in armies and lose their lives in the eye of a battle. Sound pretty familiar. But anyway, it goes on to be said.
Yes,
sound pretty familiar, don't it? It's kind of scary how familiar it is. He says, because you didn't choose me, you choose the ideal to operate a position like every other nation around you. Yeah. Do not try to act like the world. You are the people of the Word of God.
Yeah.
Somebody say hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
It's a place in which we got to stand in the ideal and be willing to stand up even when it ain't correct.
Yeah.
When it don't look correct.
Oh.
You see, they were so consumed because they thought about political correctness. Everybody else got a king, while we ain't got a king. Everybody else got somebody walking with a crown. Why we don't have somebody walking with a crown? My thing was, if you didn't have a human king, you had the King of Kings. You had the King of Israel. You had the King of Glory. But he wasn't enough, so we choose by this something that we could be in acceptance with other folk rather than be obedient with God.
Yes.
Can I help you yourself Tuesday? Please don't try to be in acceptance with other folk, and please be obedient to God.
Yes.
I can't tell you who to vote for. One, do it, because I can't do that. But I can tell you the way that you should vote. Godly way.
Amen.
Somebody say amen.
Amen.
And until you, it has to become important to you. It has to become important to you.
Yes.
The challenge becomes not only that, but also this, that just like our schools and our courtrooms, they didn't want God to be in them or around them. But I knew found something that you can move all the stuff, the things and the material of God away from you, but you will never move the spirit of God away.
Amen.
You'll never take away the hunger of God, the want of God, desire of God, the faith of God. You can't take that away. They can get him out of the schools, they might not pray. They can get him out of the courtroom, they might take out the words. But that word of God goes in every time you go in. Every time you send your child to school that loves God, the word of God goes in. They thought we was contained in the idea of something, the idea of a box, but we are people that carry our God with us wherever we go. Somebody say hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Don't you know choosing not to vote, it might not be rebellion, but it is surrender.
Yes.
Choosing not to vote is not rebellion, but it is surrender.
Right.
You're giving somebody else the choice to make decisions in your life and for your life, sometimes for the rest of your life.
Jesus.
Somebody say neighbor.
Neighbor.
I hope you get the importance of your vote.
I hope you get the importance of your vote.
And it's so strong that not only does it affect generations, and it affects the character of a nation like with the idea of Saul. Because Saul was unstable, so Israel became unstable.
My.
Saul was inferior in the idea of his own infirmities and what he looked like. Because every time David went by, he started tripping. He couldn't control himself. He went into angers. He went into steps out. He became very unstable in his mentality and mentality and all that kind of stuff. And so Israel became just as unstable as their leader. So be careful who you make your leader, because your nation will be a reflection of your leader. You're gonna work today, whether you like it or not. Alright, so your vote and the idea of Genesis lets us see the idea of how it affects one generation and the next generation. Then that vote affects the idea of a nation, the idea of Saul becoming unstable. Then it also affects the idea of who is for the kingdom and who's against the kingdom. One decision, the idea of that reveals it. Here it is in John chapter 18. It says this: "But you have a custom that I should release unto you at Passover, if you will. Therefore I release to you the King of the Jews." Or they cried against him, saying, "Not this man, but give us Barabbas." Yeah. Tell your neighbor, in case you missed it, they voted against Jesus. It was. They wanted Barabbas. They didn't mind the iniquity, because they didn't want to agree. Watch this. They didn't want to submit to the glory. And the reason that men are trying to get the laws of God, the mind of God, the presence of God, the promise of God out of the system of men, we don't want to submit to him. Yeah. And so they thought if we kill him, we won't have to humble ourselves to him. Yeah. Damn, they thought wrong. The Bible says if they had known that they would never have kingdomed the King of glory. So literally, over and over, our vote affects generations. Our vote affects a nation. Our vote affects the things of the kingdom. See, they voted for sin rather than the Son.
Yeah. Amen.
Be careful what you vote for on Tuesday. I hope it lines up with the Son and not line up with sin. Yeah. Woo. Yeah. Pastor, you preaching even if we quiet today. It's all right, though. We're going to get help today in the name of Jesus, because it's necessary that you come out. You have people that can think as long as you can. I know you can worship, but we need to know how to think. Next, go ahead with me. Here's some history, because I want you to get this, because I want you to not think that we're not a people, that we're not a people of wisdom, that we're not a people of position, that we're not a people of election, that we're not a people of government, that we are people that have a long history of understanding how to operate in authority, by authority, and through authority. How I know? 1872, the first colored senator and representative from the 41st and 42nd Congress of the United States. Here's brothers are. Here the brothers are. I said it, here the brothers are. Right after Reconstruction, they was only about 50 years out of slavery, but then they got up and began to take territory, begin moving it. See, what they forgot was, if we got more slaves, we were outnumbered. But they didn't think that the people could think. So when they thought the ideal of it, every plantation around them had slaves on them. When they dropped slavery, we had more African Americans in the counties than we had, watch this, other cultures. And so they didn't realize it, to the point in which you'll find this if you go back into Reconstruction. You'll find that there was, over this Reconstruction period and right before it, there were over 2,000 African Americans in the Congress. How come it ain't in our history books? Because I don't ever want you to think that you could ever have authority and understanding how to operate over your community, be able to run your family, and be able to have dignity of how to run a country.
Well,
then you pray for your pastor. Pray for your pastor. Pray for him. He probably need a lot of help. I do. The most important aspect of Reconstruction was the idea of the active participation of African Americans, including thousands of former slaves, in political, economic, social life of the South. The eras were to a great extent defined by the quest of autonomy of equal rights under the law, both as individuals and for black communities. During the Reconstruction, some 2,000 African American held public office from local level all the way up to the Senate level, though they never achieved representation in government proportionate to their numbers. Then excuse me, you better act like you know how to govern something. No, you need to say it like I said it. You need to act like you know how to govern something. You won't be the first one that led something, guided something, was over something, led your community, led your city, led the idea of authority and made it look like. You ain't the first one. We had people way back in the 1800s that took authority in our government and in our system and led them.
Amen.
Your neighbor? One more question. Do you know the importance of your vote and the value of it?
Yes.
They made up an overwhelming majority of Republican voters that formed a coalition called Carpetbaggers, derogatory terms referring to the recent arrival from the North to the South of white Republicans, respectively. A total of 265 African-American delegates were elected. More than 100 of them had been born into slavery, but then was taken territory. Well, what is your excuse for not voting?
Well,
cause. Almost half of the elected black delegates from served South Carolina and Louisiana. They're black with the longest history of political organization. In other states of African Americans with underrepresented, but in all, 16 African Americans served the U.S. Congress during the Reconstruction. Why in our history book? More than 600 of them were elected to state legislation, and also hundreds of them held offices all across the South.
My.
Say, why is this necessary? Because we don't value what we don't know.
Amen.
Go ahead with me, Bert. Turn to this next one for me.
Come on.
See, that led up to the place at which in the 1950s and 60s where we can get into the reality of the battle for what we call our rights now. During that civil rights period, say, why is this important? This is important because I realize we're about two generations that don't have the balance and the foundation of what the last three generations had. So if you don't value it, you don't protect it. So not you, but maybe grandmama and them was hosed down when they tried to go vote. Not you, but maybe great-grandmama and them had dogs sicked on them and the ideal of trying to vote and the ideal of their life.
My Lord.
And so if you don't value it, the people that were willing to get shot for it, up for it, sprayed for it, bit for it, and they give us the opportunity, we have a responsibility. Responsibility to understand that.
Yes.
Right.
If you don't vote for yourself, then vote for them.
Yes.
Right.
Wow.
Right.
Amen.
Come on.
Say praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Come on, give the Lord another shout of praise right here. Let's go. Not only the idea of the importance of it, but the Voting Act and act here signed into law by President Lyndon Johnson, and the idea that he signed it in 1965. That wasn't too long ago, by the way, in case you can't count. That wasn't too long ago, in case you can't count. It's only 2015, in case you can't count. Yeah. All right. Aimed at overcoming legal barriers at state and local levels to prevent African Americans exercising their right to vote, the 15th Amendment in 1870, the Constitution of the United States, it acts significantly widened the franchise, considered among the most far-reaching pieces of civil rights legislation in history. Somebody say, we need to thank God right about there.
Hallelujah.
Oh yeah. It's God. Oh, it is God. I don't even think about that, but I want to pretty clearly understand a couple things in that process, because up till 1965, what would happen when people go to vote, they had put systems in place. Systems like the idea of this, you had to fill out the idea of your application. The only problem was that was many times the slaves didn't have school systems, so they couldn't write.
That's right.
Then if they had that, they would tell them you had to pay a poll tax. And they normally put the poll tax so high, most of them didn't have the money to pay for it.
That's right.
Come on, I'm just trying to give you history, because sometimes if you don't know the history of the thing, you might think, oh, it's just a vote. No, this is life or death for some people, and for all of us, it's life or death for us. Not only that, they told them sometimes when they showed up at the poll, it's tomorrow. They told them it was the next day. They told them that, no, you can't do it. Why? You don't have enough money. So many different issues they had put up in the ideal of blocking their opportunity to take a right that they had been given to be to operate in it. That's why I don't want us to be to sit back and act like it's just another day.
Yes.
Let's go, Bird. Let's move. Let me finish this out. He says this, not only is it important to vote, but you need to see the influence of God behind the vote. Say, neighbor.
Neighbor.
I need you to get this.
Just in case.
Who you vote for, don't win.
Okay.
Yeah, I want you to see the influence that God has, not only the necessity of how important it is, but the sovereignty and the ability of God, His capacity to work. There was a time in Exodus, and the Lord said to Moses, see, I have made you a God to Pharaoh, and Aaron, thy brother. Shantarabakata. What you mean? That means that the person who is over the entire nation, let's call him, I know he was a Pharaoh and a king, but let's call him the president for a moment. Yeah. That if he was the president, Joseph was the vice president.
Come on.
That he took somebody from slavery all the way up to authority, to be able to put them in position so that his nation, his people, would have somebody in the present that could influence the ear of the one over them.
Right.
Don't you tell me God don't have agents in specific places, right, and he can strategically place them where he wants them so that he can get the mind of the person over the nation and have a govern the nation. And if you bold enough, you might be a change agent your own self.
Amen.
Are you hearing me? Why do I need, the apostle said it the other week, if I got the ear of the person in authority, I don't even need to be in authority. I had the ear of the one that was in authority. Okay, let me bring it down to our level. Moses was over the Department of Agriculture for the whole country. Yeah, he was saved.
Come on.
Cool brother.
Uh-huh.
He's in the family of those in authority. But he ran agriculture. The reason I know he ran agriculture is anytime you can make a country last 40 years with no money, and your clothes not run out, and your shoes don't blow up, you must know something that don't nobody else know. I'm talking about an educated man being able, I'm talking about a color. I don't know what color he was, but he had some color on him.
Amen. Amen.
He was able to govern nations. He was trained up by their system. He grew up in Pharaoh's house, got the education, graduated with an MD in the ideal of agriculture, engineering, and law. That's why he wrote the five first books of law.
Yeah.
See, if you ever get your brain out of kindergarten, we could really take a nation. If you don't take a whole to the king and govern everything. You might find people like the ideal of a Joseph. So now, that not so that you would send me here, but God made me to have me, made me a father to Pharaoh. Hold up, hold up. He made Moses a god to one Pharaoh. He made Joseph a father to another one. Don't you tell me God can't influence a government. Don't you tell me he can't take over Washington. Don't you tell me he can't take over whoever they put in position. Because none of them was godly. None of them knew God, heard God, saw God. They just happened to hang out with a person that went to church. Deliverance for my people. And she brought in and she works her influence and shifts the nation. One woman. Don't you tell me God can't run things from behind the scenes. So don't you lose your nerve no matter who gets elected. What I said was, don't you lose your nerve no matter who gets elected. We ain't even got to get the office. We got the planet. So he got this wonderful saved Christian that worships Jesus and God. He honors him in fact that stands next to him and tells him, they said, go find a man and do all this. You don't have the goods, you don't have the gift, you don't have the anointing, you don't have, you might have position, but you ain't got the influence. So God sets up people who can have influence behind the scene to be able to govern the mindset of those that have position so that the kingdom has an influence over a nation.
Thank you.
My God.
He does it with Daniel. Makes him an educating president. God help us. He makes him a president that can tell Nebuchadnezzar where to go, what to do, how to handle it, to the point eventually by chapter 2, by chapter 4, by chapter 6, Nebuchadnezzar and Darius all at one point say that the God of Daniel is the God of the nation.
Yeah.
Oh, you ain't playing with me right here. Come on. If he can put one person in position to change three different kings over three to be able to function and influence them, why are we tripping about who governed it in Washington?
Come on.
Mm-hmm. Neighbor.
Neighbor.
Could you give him a shot real quick?
Hallelujah.
I want you to think, beloved. I want you to think. The Bible says Daniel was one of the three presidents whom Daniel was the first of the princes that give accounts to them that the king should have no damages. Then this Daniel was preferred of above all other presidents. Because he had principles, but he also had an excellent spirit was in him. Why do I need to be at my best? Because God might want me to influence the entire government.
Jesus.
Jesus.
I hope you understand the importance and the value of your vote. Look at this next one. Look. This cat, he was serving dishes. The king said unto me, what do you want your request to be? So I prayed to the God of heaven. God gave Nehemiah, watch this, he gave him an army, he gave him sustenance, influence, he gave him an agreement for everything that he would build. That he goes from serving as a waiter one day to a city controller the next day. Say influence.
Influence.
I want you to lay your hands on your head. God, help me to see right. God, help me to see right. Help me stop looking at television and see the kingdom. Help me to see the kingdom, God. Help me to see the kingdom, God. Help me to understand the influence you want for us to be in position to move this nation, God. It ain't even about who has the office. It's about God. Influence me to get to your heart. And if you put me near him, I tell him about the kingdom, God. Come on and give him a good shout of praise. Y'all think, baby, think. God don't need no office. He got too much grace for that. There's one person, and Esther, the king said to her, girl, where you coming in from? He said to the girl, what is your request? You can have up to half of my kingdom.
Yes.
God can get one person that can walk in the office and say, excuse me, Mr. Obama. And Mr. Obama could be so favored by them. He says, what do you want in the United States?
Amen.
What if that person was a Christian? God. I just want one thing. And one thing was in his ear for the last 8 years is saying, don't, because you don't know. Defensive Marriage Act. What if they showed up every day? Defensive Marriage Act. Maybe they might be like that judge in the New Testament that you came so much every day, so much, I'm going to give you what you want.
Yes.
How come we can't just think a little bit higher? How come we can't think a little bit further? How come we just push into it? That even when it came to the Apostle Paul, but the Lord said to him, go thy way, he's a chosen vessel unto me, to bear his name before Gentiles and kings and the children of Israel. Hit that's the book of verse. And this is when he says this. He says, literally, go back. When he says this, what he says in that last part is that the children of Israel and Gentiles. If you look over in the New Testament, there's a day that he shows up before King Agrippa. Oh, it's a beautiful day. It's a day that he stands up and he tells Agrippa his own testimony. He says, don't be so deep. They don't know all the scriptures, so you don't need to hit them with every one of them right there. That tell them your testimony. The Bible says he stood before Agrippa and told him his testimony. What happened to him and how he saw the light, how he fell off his horse, and all those kind of things, and how it changed his heart. I went from destroying the church to building the church, was preaching all my life, and had all the things that happened to me. By the time he gets done preaching, guess what Agrippa says? Agrippa says, Paul, doggone it, you almost made me become a Christian. Shout out! Somebody shout hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Let's go, Bird. Close this thing out because this is the idea of the idea of the idea. The influence, not only the idea of the importance of my vote, but understanding the immutable and the place of sovereignty of God. Say sovereignty.
Sovereignty.
The Bible says that the heavens are thine, the earths are thine, and for the world, and the fullness thereof, you fell to them. Then he goes on to Daniel and says, Daniel chapter 2:21, he says, for he changes the times and seasons and removes kings. Say that with me, removes kings.
Remove kings.
If one get too crazy, God will take him out himself.
Amen.
Or her out himself.
Amen.
I just wanted to be politically correct when I said that. Okay, if anybody get too crazy, God can take him out himself. Stop tripping. The Secret Service ain't got nothing for Jesus. They ain't got nothing for if Jesus wanted, Jesus will get him wherever he wants to get him, when he wants to get him. He can pull one of them off the seat in a moment. He can take his hair, and they be gone. Don't you forget the sovereignty of who your God is. Don't you understand Psalm 35? It says promotion comes neither from the east, it don't come from the west, it don't come from the south, but it is God who judges.
That's right.
He puts one down, and he will set up another. Hey, excuse me. But no, God knows what's going on.
Yeah.
You need to give him a shout right about here. Come on. Come on, act like thinking of a neighbor. Could you act like you know? I mean, for real. Act like you know the importance of your vote. Act like you know the influence that's behind it. Act like you know the immutable power and the sovereignty of God that can put whoever he want, wherever he want, whenever he want. He's omniscient, omnipresent, know everything, know everybody, know everywhere. He knows the hairs on my head. He knows how many times I blink today. He knows nothing gets past him. Yes. Hey, by the way, he really ain't scared of nobody's part. Let's close it out. Verse says this. Romans 3 says, let every soul be subject to the power thereof. And he said, therefore, no, there's no power but of God. And the powers that are ordained are of God. Daniel says, this matters by the decree of the watchers and by the demand of the words of the holy ones. That's who we are. He says, in the intent that the living may know that the Most High rules in the kingdom of men. And he will give it to whomsoever he wills and set it up by the basis of men. Say, excuse me. Maybe put it to you in a neighborhood way. God can do whatever he want to do. And he can do whatever he want to do. Whenever he want to do what he want to do, what he want to do. And he really don't need us to do. God.
Thank you, Lord.
It says, God is the king of all the earth. That's why you should sing and praise with some understanding.
Hallelujah, man.
Romans says, for the scripture says unto Pharaoh, even for the same reason I raised you up, that I might declare throughout the whole earth and bring my name glory. And that means like a strange thought. He said, why did he raise up Pharaoh? So that after the greatest nation on the planet saw God shut it down. When they saw God shut their economy down, their money down, their living down, their houses down, wipe out their family, all of that. Because they were saying that the Egyptians was the greatest kingdom ever living. And God shut it all down.
Come on.
He said, the only reason I made you is really so that I could get victory over you and get the glory.
Come on.
That's a sovereign God.
Yeah.
In other words, I just made you so that they would see my victory and give me glory.
Yes.
My
glory.
I want you to understand very clearly, there ain't nothing in your life that can take your God out and that he ain't sovereign.
Yes.
I don't care if it's from your house to the White House.
Yes.
I said, I don't care if it's from your house to the White House.
Thank you, God.
Say, our God.
A sovereign God.
Come on and give him a praise right there.
Bless the Lord.
I want you to understand the importance of your vote. I want you to understand the influence that goes behind it, even if you don't understand who wins. I ain't even scared. I'm going to do my part. Because there's a part of sovereignty that God's going to do his part, but also he wants us to do our part. He's going to handle it. He's got it. And no matter who gets in, he got them. He can deal with them. The Bible says it this way. He would touch the king's heart and turn it whichever way he will. Like the rivers of water, he could turn the king's heart. Good. So no matter who get in, he can get their heart.
Yes.
Like I said, Social Security can't do nothing about it. Come on. So he can minister to anywhere, anybody, at any time. So God's not thrown off. He declares the end from the beginning. Matter of fact, this election has been done, and he's so far done with this election. He's been done with this election for over from the beginning. He knew who was going to be elected Tuesday like 2 million years ago. He ain't fooled by nothing, tricked by nothing, and moved by really little bit of nothing. But what he is moved by is those that would worship him and obey him. God. We got to take our stands and take our part. Stand to your feet. What's the treatment that we get about God is that he tells us in John, says this.